sort of something like that. So I'm recording this on the next day, actually. And
I'll probably actually, for this recording, I might
do it over a couple days of gameplay, just because, I'm busy with some things. But, yeah, where we left off, we just came back to this island without the cube, so we're gonna need to go back. I think I will probably do like more games like that. Oh. Game's glitched. Okay, we are gonna do our absolute best. The way up. That's hilarious. I'm hoping I can land there. This is hilarious. Okay, I think we might just have to die. I can make this leap here. Not done. Yeah. Oh, beautiful. Okay, we can walk. Okay, that is hilarious that this has happened. So weird. I've never had that glitch happen before. That's hilarious. What a way to start a video, eh? Well, since I see appears there's nothing else on this one. But let's scan you. Ancient Flota.
They once floated on the surface.
They can't survive in the water. So it's pretty cool, honestly. Let's do this.
Our first teleporter. So let's go in, shall we?
Signatures on the island's surface.
So now, if we came here before, this wouldn't have been activated. But because we activated on that side, now it's active both ways. So it's not just a one-way teleport, but a two-way teleporter that needs to be activated on one side. Which is a pretty cool concept, honestly.
because it forces you then to explore, right? Rather than just being like, oh, okay, now I can get here for free. Like, this, this way really just kind of helps you explore, which I think is pretty awesome. Okay, now let's go explore this new place. So as you're gonna see, hard to see with the two icons there, but it's 2,000 meters away. So we teleported quite a distance. And this is pretty cool. It's interesting, right? Like, where are we? Where are we? There's a lot to explore on this island, so we're gonna do our best to try and get it all, just in one trip, because you don't really have to come back. Like, you can come back here for things. Like, I might for, like, plants and stuff, but, yeah, right now, I don't really want, I just want the resources. It will lead you to different areas where you can find things, like this, for example. This is what we're here for. An exterior grow bed. Which is good, because
now we can grow things outside.
There's one here. Ah, here we go. Here we go. Okay. Tell you what, since we're... Oh.
What are you?
What am I? That is a good question. Well, I'm CJ. I'm Oh man. Yeah, okay, so we got beauty. Okay, we do got some things. So I'll tell you what, we're gonna listen to these and I'll just let these play, and because all the words here is actually just played in the audio, so I'll let you guys listen to these while I'm just doing things.
Claustrophobic living underwater. Father feels it is. He'd tell me it was childish, but I stare out of the window and sometimes I think how lucky I am to see this world up close. Back on the island, I wouldn't have believed the creatures that live down here. The fish, they glow. There's one that's 90% eyeball. Snakes twice the length of a habitat compartment. Certainly, it's not all friendly. Most of the plant life is toxic. I learned that the hard way. But I've managed to coax some marble melons into growing indoors. And when they don't cover our dietary needs, well, we eat the fish themselves. It's a bit gross, but there's nothing they wouldn't do. I've been attempting to document my findings. Father approves. He says understanding is power. That the more we know about this planet, the more we can use it to our advantage. I'm just doing it because it's fun. It's not easy without proper equipment and network access. But the old-fashioned way, observing, taking notes, testing theories, shows me the world in a way a spectroscopic analysis never could. Lately, I've been watching the crab snakes. They ambush their prey as it tries to feed on the mushrooms they hide in. What they don't eat settles on the seabed, which fertilizes the mushrooms, which feeds the herbivores, and so the chain continues. Co-evolution gives me the fuzzies. Something incredible just happened. Since we're down here, I had this plan to build equipment and study the life forms we were encountering, but I didn't have enough enameled glass. So, I started looking for a natural substrate that would strengthen the glass we have, and those stalker teeth we've been finding fit the bill. Only, well, we needed more. That's when Marguerite got interested. She actually listened to me, more than I can say for Father. And I worked up the courage to talk about my more tentative theories. When I told her they were attracted to metal deposits, that their teeth get dislodged when they pick them up, her eyes narrowed and she dashed out of the room. 3 hours later, she came back, her pack loaded down with stalker teeth. I asked her about it. She shrugged and said my theories were good. Said she had them eating out of the palm of her hand. I think she meant it literally. She is incredible. She went out to the kelp forest, armed with just a heat blade, and went fin to fin with a pack of stalkers. On the one hand, that is the coolest thing I have ever heard. On the other, Well, I hope the stalkers didn't come off worse than Marguerite did. She had a huge gash on her forearm. I don't think things went as smoothly as she made out. And what's the point in surviving here if we have to kill everything that makes it so wonderful? I wish I knew more about these animals. But Father won't let me leave the habitat. Maybe with all this glass, we could build a containment unit and get up close to them.
Integrate new PDA data.
This is the first time I've seen sunlight in months. After all that time in the deep, I'd been dreaming of it. Now that I'm back here, I'm finding it hard to enjoy alone. Father was right. We should never have left this place. We shouldn't have gone so deep. They do not want us down there. Despite my best efforts, ill health is taking hold of me. The visions are getting worse. Marguerite and Father are now part of the ecosystem of this incredible planet. It's reassuring to know that when I go, I'll join them. Until then, well, there's always the view.
This part didn't make it. None of them made it. Okay.
This island is a godsend. Look out of the window. No predators. Fresh food.
No building materials. Nothing left of the ship. And your kid says we're gonna starve without more grow beds. Speak up, kid.
It's true, Father. The natural growth rates are too slow to keep supporting us.
All I'm saying is ocean's got us surrounded. No use hiding. Sooner or later, we'll get our feet wet.
The rest of your life may have been a fight, Maida, but I've made my decision. You want to forfeit your emergency pay to take a swim? Go ahead.
Believe me, I'm thinking.
Son, I said wait for the storm to pass. Your life's more valuable to me than a plant patch.
You stopped being in charge when the ship you were captaining sunk.
I'll stop being in charge when you take charge of yourself.
Say, Chief. Chief.
What?
Do you know how to drain those grow beds of 40 tons of storm water? Or how to conjure food from the air?
I know how to prioritize.
I'm just saying, if that's so, what's your boy's life worth to you today, if tomorrow you're gonna be so hungry you start wondering what he tastes like? Let him go deal with your plants.
Son, go deal with the plants.
Bard, Torgal has disembarked the habitat.
Interfere with my family again, and when rescue arrives, I will leave you here. Do you understand me?
No rescue coming, Chief. Not in time. No staying here neither. This rain keeps falling, sooner or later this place will be buried. Only choice we got is whether to get buried with it. You see, Chief, you brought us to this sodden planet. Told us we'd see a lush payday. Now what do we got some 6 weeks later? A dead crew, a habitat that's half buried, food washed away.
I suppose the executive decisions would be better left to someone with your extensive experience of hitting people in the face.
I know enough not to take unscheduled detours to uncharted planets. That's something you don't want to learn the hard way.
Easy to judge a decision in hindsight. Harder to come up with a plan of your own.
Got one already. Take what we can carry and hunker down in a cave somewhere. I scouted a site. A couple hundred meters deep, lots of metal deposits.
How do you imagine we'd live?
With ready access to building materials? Like damn queens. A couple of water filters, a bioreactor, fresh fish. But Chief, we'll eat seaweed salad and drink our own urine if that's what it takes. All that matters is, do you got something better?
Send the coordinates to my PDA. I'll review your proposal.
New blueprint acquired.
What is that thing?
I don't know. I found it outside in the sand.
Part of another ship?
None I've ever seen.
It's not even scratched.
Don't fool around with it. It might be worth something.
Stand down, Chief. If it were gonna crumble to dust, it would have done so when I picked it up.
It's glowing.
We're not the first people to come to this planet.
People? Maybe. Could be aliens. Could be the damn sea monsters for all we know. One thing for sure, we ain't gonna find out by staying here.
Son, there is always a pecking order. And in our world, money makes a hierarchy. I pay Maida a fraction of what I pay you, and you a fraction of what I pay me.
If money makes the hierarchy, why is Marguerite making the decisions?
We need her. We let her think what she likes, so long as she does what she's told.
What if she doesn't?
For enough money, she will. People always do. We're already 200 meters below sea level. You want to go deeper?
Look around us, Chief. Water leaking through the hull, water outside the hatch. We're drowning real slow. If rescue arrives, whatever shot us down, it's gonna do it again and again until it's shut off. You see an off switch around here, Chief?
Why would it any more likely be half a kilometer down?
Welcome aboard, Captain. Kid found something on the scanner. There's something down there. Something that shouldn't be.
You're mad.
I'm going all the same, and I've an idea you two are gonna follow. But if you do, be mindful. Your authority stopped at sea level. These conniving corporate bourgeois, inbred, incompetent, self-absorbed jerks don't have a damn clue. It's not so bad. He's even useful. But I swear, everything that comes out of his father's idiot face is a narcissistic lie. He wants to stay in this cave? His problem. I'm the one doing the heavy lifting. When sea monsters are hunting you, you don't hide. You hunt the sea monsters. Then you build a bigger boat out of sea monster bones and you hunt bigger monsters. Keep going until there aren't any monsters left to hunt. I'm going deeper. I'm gonna find what shot us down, and I'm gonna tear its damn heart out. I've started the prep work. The kids taught me how to make enameled glass. I've started stockpiling metal ores to build myself a sea moth. I'll raid the indoor grow beds before I leave.
You know what Maida told me today? Chief's log, 5 weeks since the crash. The only other survivors are my son, Mott, and Maida, the cut-price mercenary I commissioned for the journey. After days drifting in the life pod, rain hammering on the roof, the weather cleared and we washed up here. I had Maida salvage the Degazi wreck, set Mott to finding us a stable source of food. His education is paying off sooner than I'd anticipated. Our only problem is Maida. She says the weather's going to turn. I say she's finding excuses to risk our lives. I imagine she's not gonna weaken her life without a physical altercation, and she's itching for a fight. In every judgment she makes, things go from bad to worse. If she had my experience, she'd have more faith. Humans have spent millennia specializing in how to shackle nature to our will. This planet won't cause us any new problems. My one task now is to keep us alive, as comfortably as possible, until the insurance company arranges rescue. In this part of space, that could be months, or even years.
Farming alien plants is a proven survival strategy. Craig McGill survived 47 months on a healthy, raw salad of live tree roaches and stank root.
You know what Maida told me today? She wants to build a habitat 500 meters below sea level, more than a kilometer northeast of here. And she needs Bart and I to do it. She's got it into her head that she can save us if she just acts recklessly enough. But I've hauled Star Wars to Neptune, Plasteel to the Federation. This family operates 9 different mining colonies across the Ariadne Arm. Maida thinks she's better suited to lead. Her contract still says otherwise. But I just cannot damn well tell whether it's the stupidest idea I ever heard, or my only hope. I turned 80 years old last week. I thought I had another 80 in me, but marooned on this planet, there's no swapping out of my liver when the old one fails. Here, I'm mortal. And Maida is useful. So, it's my responsibility to make a decision. Return to the island and hope whatever knocked the Degazi out of the sky won't do the same to the rescue ship. Or take us deeper in search of answers. And all the while be hoping old age gets me before the sea monsters do. I'll give Maida just one thing. She was right about these caves. There's enough lithium there to fabricate 100 tons of Plasteel. Enough for a damn fleet of Cyclops submarines. There was nothing anyone could have done to avoid crashing here. But I was right to order the detour. If we get off this planet, they'll be talking about the Torgel share price on the other side of the Federation.
It's crazy what money will do to people. And, what's his name? And Paul Torgel. He's driven by money, and that's leading them to, as we find out from Bart, his son, his last log. They die.
We have to board the Aurora, repair the long-range comms, make contact with the other survivors. We can't be the only two that made it.
Those are not the orders the captain gave me, and they are not the orders I'm giving you.
This isn't chain of command, it's survival.
My obligations as acting commander don't turn on their convenience. Get out of the water.
If I get into trouble, I'll send you my coordinates.
I can't let you go alone.
Then come with me.
You don't leave me much choice.
Received emergency transmission from Second Officer Keane, 2 hours after last activity.
Rendezvous was a failure. Intercepted a transmission from Altera HQ. Seems they sent a data package to the Aurora. We were intercepted by a Leviathan-class Predator before we could reach the ship. Consider the CTO and I lost at sea. Be safe. Keen. Out.
How do we know?
I priority automated message from Aurora Live Pod 13. Coordinates attached. Live Pod is carrying high priority passenger.
Yoki Kassar. I said Kassar. Why do I have to record this anyway?
Send immediate burial detail.
This is Altera HQ. May be your only communications window. We can't send a rescue ship all the way out there, so Aurora, you're just gonna have to meet us halfway. We've uploaded blueprints to the ship's computer.
We're doing a sandwich run, you in?
Yeah, give me a second. Black box data shows the high security terminal in the captain's quarters is still functional.
Becky's leaving like in 5 minutes.
All right, well, tell Becky I'll just take the regular.
Regular?
Yeah, she'll know what I mean. The code should
and
be...
if she doesn't?
Just tell her the regular, dude.
Okay,
the
if co- I say regular, she's like, what's the regular? All the way back up here.
The code should be 2679. The regular is just a ham and cheese.
Okay, would you just say ham and cheese?
Ham and cheese.
Okay.
I don't know the egg.
Leviathan class. Life forms in the region. Are you certain whatever you're doing is worth it?
No, I'm not sure. Okay, we're just going multiple. That's what's got me feeling a little nervous. Okay, we'll keep it angled like right here. We'll grab one of our beacons. Oh.
quiet.
Okay.